morning, all. There we go. Good morning. Good morning. It is so wonderful to have Sammy home at the organ bench this morning. Thank you so much. It's a real blessing that you have. That even though Sandy's in semi-retirement, she's still willing and able to play while Christy is away. It's a real blessing, and I really enjoy it. So I enjoy both Sandy and Christy. What a blessing to be able to have that kind of a gift to play a wonderful instrument like that. I wish my decades of dance lessons, I wish were piano lessons. I got the dance lessons, my sister and brother got the piano lessons, I don't know. Oh, it is good to be here this morning. It's good to be back. So many folks have asked. Yes, Roger and I had a fabulous vacation. I'm energized. You better watch out. The weather was almost perfect our whole entire time away. All of my family were able to gather for most of a week, and we haven't done that since the pandemic, so it was really a good time. And then we went from Leland, Michigan, where we vacationed with my children and grandchildren, up to Copper Harbor, where we just spent time together in seclusion, which is not too hard to do up there. And I will let you know that the leaves are already beginning to change. It's the middle of August, right? Not even the end of August. And we saw a lot of trees already beginning to change. So, you should have received two extra things this morning. You should have gotten an insert on James, some background information for you to read at a later time, or if you're bored during the service, I guess you could read it then. To help us, you know, with our knowledge, learning more and more about God's Word for our lives. And you should have received a little green ribbon. Everybody got one? The beach ball prayers are on. And now you're going to be tied in knots. So during our prayer time today, because we're thinking about prayer, we're thinking about asking God for the things we need, you're going to take that green ribbon and you're going to think of some things that are concerning to you, something you're worried about. Of course, we're not supposed to worry in Christ, but something that's concerning to you, think about it. Tie your knot. If there's two or three things that you're concerned about, tie those knots. We'll take a moment or two to do that during prayer time. And then you're going to find somebody else to share your strength with. You don't have to tell them what your concerns are. You may, if you so choose. Try to find somebody, you know, different than the person sitting next to you. They probably already know what you're concerned about. We're going to use this form of prayer, tied in knots, for the next several weeks as we experience prayer in all different kinds of ways. I hope it's a blessing. Announcements for this morning. Oh, and by the way, I'm thrilled that the kids are here today. Yay. The next free community meal at the St. Louis facility is this Tuesday. The menu has changed. It's Sloppy Joe's baked beans instead of a pulled pork sandwich. So if you know of somebody that needs a warm, friendly, free meal, tell them about the meal over there. It starts at 4:30. Everything is still served car side. You just drive up to the west entrance and tell them how many meals you need, and they'll get you your meals for free. So if you know somebody that needs that, please, please tell them about it. This is a community ministry. The other thing is just a correction. Some people already know about this, but your church charge conference, so your conference with you in St. Louis, is not Saturday, September 10th. That's the SPRC meeting between the two churches with the district superintendent. Your church charge conference is October 30th. It's a Sunday. And so we'll get that changed in print, and all of those meetings are at the Alma United Methodist Church. So we'll get that changed on the bulletin this week. Also, there's not going to be a movie night in August. Those that will come back in September. It's just too busy as the kids are getting ready to go back to school. So just make those notes. And with that, we'll ask Miss Eden to lead us strongly.
Join me in the call of worship, on the screen or in your bulletin. Could everyone please stand up? Wisdom speaks to us.
We will not shut out the lesson wisdom teaches.
Wisdom cries out a warning.
We will not ignore wisdom's guidance.
Wisdom calls to us.
We will dwell on the house of the Lord forever.
Our opening hymn is in United Methodist Hymnal 399, or on the screen, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Give us your peace where our hatred and anger threatens. Give us your joy amidst our depression, and most of all, give us your love, which overwhelms our apathy. May your Holy Spirit surround and indwell this congregation now and forevermore. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Well, we have kiddos this morning, so come and join me. That's awesome. It's always awesome. And I know that these weekends are really busy for all of you because you're getting ready shortly now to go back to school. And by the way, next week, if you can be here next week, everybody's going to receive something really special for school. So hopefully you can make time in the schedule to go back to school and still be here. So when I was growing up, there were things that I learned from my mom, and a lot of things I learned from my grandmother, my mother's mother. And one of those things is a really important lesson for all of us, but especially as we get ready for school, and that was, if you don't have anything nice to say,
don't say
nothing at all. Whether they're kind words or whether they're not kind words, once they're out of our mouth, we can never gather them back in. Isn't that true? So they do a lot of damage. We need to think first. Yes, there's times when our thoughts get angry and our thoughts get kind of mean-spirited. That happens to all of us. We gotta watch what we say, because once that's out there, there's no way to take it back. So, as you go back to school, think about that. If somebody says something unkind to you, the very best thing we can do is say nothing at all, or even say something kind back to them. It's hard to do that because we wanna give it right back to them, don't we? But that doesn't help anything. And even adults need to learn that, because so often we say things that we shouldn't say, things that God would not want us to say. And so this is a lesson for all of us as you prepare for school. Maybe some of us need to go back to school too. So think about keeping your mouth closed, saying nothing at all, unless you can say something nice. Our words. This is what scripture says. Reckless words are like a sword. He who holds his tongue is wise. And this is something I say every Sunday when I walk up to the altar or to the stairs. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts combined be acceptable in thy sight, Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. You are a blessing to us. We want to be a blessing to you. And I'm sure you would just love to have some red wax lips, wouldn't you? Of course. Just remember the lesson that's in them. Because that's the important part. God's blessings. You bless me. All right. The kids are going to go back to the play area or to their seats or wherever they're going to go. Sunday school will be starting again in just a few weeks now. And we have some really special things being planned for our children.
And saved all those who believed in his message.
corporation is immortal, invisible, God only wise, United Methodist Temple 103, or on the screen. Jealousy and selfish ambition, there is disorder and everything that is evil. What of the wisdom from above? First, it is pure, and then peaceful, gentle, obedient, filled with mercy and good actions, fair and genuine. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you so much, Edith. Which one of you would like more wisdom? I'll keep him up there for a minute. Sometimes two hands up, and most of you have a hand up. Not all, there were some that didn't put their hand up. And that's okay. We do have wise people amongst us, praise God for that. But most of us feel like we could use more wisdom. What is wisdom to you? What makes a person wise? And where does wisdom come from? How do we receive wisdom? Those are the things we're going to look at today in this first week of looking at the book of James, the epistle of James, walk it, don't just talk it. We're looking at wisdom today according to James. couple of weeks ago, but who's James? Who is James? Say it louder.
Half-brother
of Jesus. Jesus had many siblings, half-siblings. Mary and Joseph went on to have several children after Jesus. So half-brother, because he is a product of Joseph and Mary, and Jesus is a product, a wonderful creative product of God and of the Spirit in Mary. James and his siblings, as well as the town that Jesus grows up in, Nazareth, do not believe that Jesus is the long-awaited Messiah. James comes to his newfound belief and newfound faith after Jesus' resurrection. That is what made the difference in his life and in ours. You know, you can think about that in a couple ways. Think about whether you have siblings or really, really good friends, close friends, if you don't have siblings. And think about somebody coming up to you and saying, "That brother Joe of yours, he's the long-awaited Messiah. He's God." How would you react? You've lived with that person your entire lifetime. You'd seen all the different things that they did and said. You know them as your human brother. And yet somebody's coming to you and saying, no, that's God. God on earth. God with all God's amazing possibilities and power. We, just like James and the rest of Jesus' brothers and sisters, might have said, "No way! I know this dude. He's my brother. He's not God." So that's where we find some background on James, who comes to faith, Christian faith, the faith in Christ, after Jesus' resurrection. And James, believe it or not, with that quick transformation in his life, becomes a leader in the church right along with Peter and Paul. That's an amazing transformation from being a denier to a believer. True conversion. Well, there's a close relationship between the passage from this morning, the first passage that Edith read, James 1:5, and what has gone on before in the epistle of James. James has just told his readers that if they use all of the testing experiences of life, what is that? Testing experiences, trials, troubles, worries, and concerns. If they used all the testing experiences of life in the right way, the correct way, the God way, they will emerge from those trials and tribulations with a stronger faith, a strength that only God can give. Hallelujah. So listen to James 1:5-8 again. This time I'm going to read from the Message so that it can be even clearer what God is trying to say to us. If you don't know what you're doing, pray to the Father. He loves to help. You'll get his help and won't be condescended to when you ask for it. Ask boldly, believingly, without a second thought. People who worry their prayers are like wind-whipped waves. master that way, for you are adrift at sea, keeping all your options open. But as soon as James tells his readers about how going through trials and tribulations will give them a stronger faith, immediately a question arises. Maybe it's the same question we would ask. Where can I find this kind of wisdom? Where can I find the understanding to use our testing experiences in life in the right way, in the way God wants us to? And James' answer back is, if we feel that we have not the wisdom to use correctly the experience of this life, and no one in him or herself possesses that wisdom, let them ask God. When you're praying, where is asking God in your order of prayer? Or asking others to pray for us? So often, the asking part and the listening and the understanding part is the last thing that we do. But asking for God's wisdom, James says, is the key. Later in the chapter, he says, you do not have because you do not ask. One thing stands out for James, the Christian teacher with the Jewish background, for remember they were raised in a Jewish faith. Wisdom is a practical thing. It's not a philosophical or an intellectual thing. It's a practical thing. Wisdom calls for action on our part. Wisdom is concerned with the business of living, of getting out of it, of making decisions, the best decisions we can, and doing something. A definition of Christian wisdom says that it is the supreme and divine quality of the soul whereby one knows and one practices righteousness. It's a taking it in, but it's also doing something with it. Dictionary says that wisdom is the endowment of heart and mind, which is needed for the right conduct of life. Again, there's an action that goes along with receiving wisdom. In Christian wisdom, there is the deep, deep knowledge of God. Things that God reveals to us in God's time. But essentially, even in Christian wisdom, it is a practical thing. It's a taking it in and then doing something with it so that it pours back out again. It's such knowledge turned into action in the decision and personal relationships of everyday life. When we ask God for that wisdom, godly wisdom, we must remember two things at least. The first thing we have to remember is how God gives. How does God give? God gives generously. God gives unconditionally. And God never asks for the gift back. never asked for the gift back or for interest in the gift that God has given. The Jewish wise men around James were well aware how the best gift in the world could be spoiled by the manner of giving. So many of us have been on that other end of receiving, haven't we? Where there was something attached to it. Depends on how the giver gives, doesn't it? Are they giving with a chalkboard? I did this for you. Are they giving, expecting double back? We've been on the receiving end of that, so we understand. But God is not that kind of giver. God gives and gives and gives in spite of how we respond. God gives and gives and gives unconditionally, never expecting anything in return. There is a kind of giver who gives only with a view of getting more back than he or she gives, who gives only to gratify their own vanity, their own sense of power, by putting the receiver under an obligation which will never be allowed to be forgotten. Have you been there as the receiver? Most of us have. There's givers who continually give something and then they cast it up before the world or before each other. I just spent a week with the family. It happens in our families. We do something and then we keep talking about it, right? I did this. It happens in the church family all the time. I did this. I want my name on that board. I want that name in the newsletter. I want to be noticed. That's a worldly giver. God is not like that. Philemon, the Greek poet, says this, called God the lover of gifts. Not in the sense of loving to receive gifts, but in the sense of loving to give gifts. Our God is a gift giver. And God doesn't cast up those gifts. He gives with all the splendor of his love, a love that we can only imagine. Because it is God's nature to give. He shows us that through Jesus our Christ. Giving and giving. So we must remember how God gives when we ask. And then secondly, we must remember how the asker must ask. Scripture says we must ask without doubt. That we must ask, believing that God will hear and answer in God's good time. We must, in asking, be sure of the power and the glory and the desire of God to give. If, as a believer, we ask in doubt or our mind, it says it's like the broken water of the sea. We're just cast about. We're just drifting back and forth. We're unstable. We're unsure. So as we ask, we have to have confidence and knowledge that God will hear and God will answer in God's time. Sometimes those answers are not our answers. God hears and will answer. James says vividly that such a person is a person with two souls. are two minds. One side believes, and the other side is an unbeliever. One side trusts, and the other side distrusts. So if we are to use the experience of life correctly to improve our character, we must ask for wisdom from God. And when we ask, we must remember the absolute generosity of God and see that it is we who are asking as believers, believing in God's power, believing that God will hear, that God will receive what we are lifting to God. Let's go to James 3:13-14 and hear what that text says again. Again, I'm going to use the message just so we can hear it even more clearly. And I hope you've opened your Bibles today in the pew. I meant to ask you to do that, to James. Do you want to be counted wise, to build a reputation for wisdom? Here's what you do. Live well, live wisely, live humbly. It's the way you live, not the way you talk, that counts. In this point, James goes back kind of to the beginning of the chapter. His argument runs like this. Is there any of you who wishes to be a real sage? Are there any of you who wish to be a spiritual teacher? Then let them live a life of such beautiful graciousness that he or she will prove to all that gentleness is enthroned as the controlling power in their heart. For if a person who desires to be a spiritual leader, a spiritual teacher, has bitterness, or if they are controlled by selfish desires, or if they exhibit arrogance in their daily walk, all they are doing is being false. They're trying to trick themselves. Be careful if you think that God is calling you to be a spiritual teacher, a spiritual leader. Be careful. For the mantle, the yoke is heavy. It's only with God carrying that yoke that makes the burden light. Joy. Hear the next part of that scripture, James 3:15-16. Mean-spirited ambition isn't wisdom. Boasting that you aren't wise isn't wisdom. Twisting the truth to make yourself sound wise isn't wisdom. It's the furthest thing from wisdom. It's animal cunning. Devilish plotting. Whenever you're trying to look better than others or get the better of others, things fall apart and everyone ends up at each other's throats. That's the message, paraphrased from John 3:15-16. That kind of wisdom, human wisdom, bitter, it's arrogant, it's different, so different from real wisdom, from God wisdom. James first describes this wisdom, this human wisdom in itself, and then he goes on to describe the effects of human wisdom rather than God's wisdom. So he tells tells us about that kind of human wisdom itself, that arrogant, bitter wisdom. He says it's earthly. Its standards and sources are earthly. It doesn't come from God. It comes from the world. Follows the worldly aims. Secondly, he says that arrogant, bitter wisdom, that human wisdom, is characteristic of the natural person. James is saying that this wrong kind of wisdom is no more than an animal kind of thing. It's the kind of wisdom that makes an animal snap and snarl with no other thought than that of a prey or personal survival. That's not the kind of wisdom that we need as Christ followers. That's not the kind of wisdom that's needed in the life of the church or us as individuals. Then James goes on to describe this arrogant and bitter wisdom in its effects. And the main thing that human wisdom, arrogant, bitter wisdom brings is disagreement, disorder. Instead of bringing people together, this arrogant wisdom drives them apart. Instead of producing peace, it produces strife. There is a kind of person who, undoubtedly clever, with a cute brain and skillful tongue, but his or her effect, nevertheless, in any committee, in any church family, in any group, in any family, is to cause trouble and to disturb personal relationships. It's a sobering thing to remember that this human earthly wisdom that we may possess is not of the divine. It's worldly. It's of the demonic instead. And its purpose is to tear it apart. Lastly, let's hear the last two verses of James 3, 17 and 18 from the Message again, because I want us to hear it a different way. It's called True Wisdom. Real wisdom, God's wisdom, begins with a holy life and is characterized by getting along with others. It is gentle and reasonable, overflowing with mercy and blessings, not hot one day and cold the next, not two-faced. You can develop a healthy, robust community that lives right with God and enjoys the results only if you do the hard work of getting along with each other, treating each other with dignity and honor. The Jewish sages were always agreed that true wisdom came from above, came from God. True wisdom is not the attainment of humankind, but it is the gift of God for God's children. James uses eight words to describe this godly wisdom. First thing James says is that true wisdom is pure. The Greek word for that pure is hagnos. Its root meaning is pure enough to approach God. Godly wisdom is pure enough to approach God. True wisdom is so cleansed of all ulterior motives and of self that it has become pure enough to see God. Worldly, bitter, arrogance, wisdom might well wish to escape God's sight, but true wisdom is able to bear God's very scrutiny. Secondly, James says true wisdom is peaceable, but it's a different kind of peace than what we think of. It's God's shalom. It's God's true peace. True wisdom produces right relationships. There's a kind of clever and arrogant wisdom which separates person from person, which makes us look with superior contempt on others. There's a kind of cruel wisdom that takes delight in hurting others with clever but cutting words. Most of us have experienced that at some point of our lives. There's a kind of depraved wisdom which seduces us away from loyalty to God. But true wisdom at all times brings closer to one another and closer to God. True wisdom at all times brings us closer to each other and closer to God. Thirdly, true wisdom, justice beyond the written law. It steps in to correct things when the law itself becomes unjust. The person who has God's wisdom is the person who knows when it is actually wrong to apply the letter of the law. It's a person that knows how to forgive when strict justice gives them a perfect right to condemn. True wisdom knows how to make allowances. It's flexible. It knows when not to stand upon our personal rights. It knows how to temper justice with mercy. Always remembers that there are greater things in the world than rules and regulations. There are greater things in the world than rules and regulations. Fourthly, true wisdom is easy to persuade. Not in the sense of being pliable and weak, but in the sense of not being stubborn, not being willing to listen. Listen to reason and listen to appeals of others. True wisdom is not rigid, but is willing to listen and skilled in knowing when wisely to yield. Fifthly, true wisdom is full of mercy and good fruits. In Christian wisdom thought, there is mercy for the one who is in trouble, even if the trouble is his or her own fault. Christian pity is the reflection of God's pity. It's not a bad thing. And that went out to people not only when they were suffering unjustly, but when they were suffering through their own fault. We are so apt to say, well, he did that to himself. She's the lone cause of her own trouble. He brought it on. She did that. And feel no responsibility. Just write them off. It's a Christian mercy. Mercy for anyone who is in trouble, even if they have trouble on themselves. In Christian thought, wisdom means mercy, which is practical help. Christian pity is not merely an emotion, it's an action. We've taken God's wisdom in, and he intends us to do something with it. We can never say that we have truly understood or truly thought about someone else or taken pity on someone else until we have helped them. God's wisdom calls us to reach out and find ways that we can help each other in times of trouble through prayer, through action, through generosity. Sixth true wisdom is undivided. This means it's not wavering, it's not vacillating. It knows its own mind. It chooses its course and it abides by it. To stay on course with Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. Christian wisdom is based on the Christian certainties which come to us from God through Jesus our Christ. That's how we get that wisdom. True wisdom is without hypocrisy. It's not a pose. It's not dealing in deception. Godly wisdom is honest. It never pretends to be what it is not. It never acts apart to gain for its own ends. Finally, James says something that every Christian church and every Christian group should have written on its heart. The harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. The harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. True wisdom makes right relationship between person to person. True wisdom makes right relationship between person and God. So then what James is saying is this. We're all trying to reap the harvest which a good life brings. But the seeds which bring the rich harvest can only flourish in an atmosphere of right relationships between all of us. That's the only way it works. And the only people who can sow those seeds and reap the reward are those whose life work has been to produce those relationships. Nothing good can ever grow in an atmosphere where people are at variance, disagreement with another. A group where there is bitterness and strife is a barren soil, just like the parable that Jesus taught, in which the seeds of righteousness can never grow, and out of which no reward can ever come. The one who disturbs or tears apart personal relationships or relationships with God is responsible for strife and bitterness. They've cut themselves off from the reward which God gives to those who live their life striving after God's ways. Wisdom, godly wisdom, walking the walk and not just talking. Let it be so. Amen.
Amen.
So if I find your little green ribbon. Lost mine already. There it is. This is where we're going to take the ribbon and think of just one thing that is concerning in your life right now. There might be two or three, but we won't have time to, you know, to spend a lot of time with the neighbor in the pew, but figure out your thing that you're concerned about and tie your knot. Let's take a moment of silent prayer in doing so. Tie your knot. As you've done that, if you are able, some of you are not, but if you are able, move about. Find somebody that you can exchange your green ribbon with for this week. Using this form of prayer for a couple of weeks. I encourage you to take this green ribbon with you today, to not just leave it in the pew for Jackie to clean up, but to put it in a pocket or a purse, so that maybe throughout the week, as you come back across it once again, you remember to pray for your own needs and for the needs of the person that you exchange with. As you continue sharing, I'm going to pray. God of wisdom, as our children are headed back to school and college to learn anew, help us pass on to them the wisdom that has been given down to us from the generations before us. Help our children as they learn their daily lessons to listen and learn. Help their teachers and patience and knowledge to teach well. Help them as they learn life lessons of dealing with other people around them. And help us as we guide them through these lessons. We ask, O Lord, for your wisdom to discern your ways and path for our own lives. We ask for your wisdom to discern how to deal with others we need, live with, work with, shop with, drive roads with, wait in line with, eat with, and be with daily. We ask for your wisdom in the difficult situations we may have to deal with as we go through life. We ask for your wisdom when voting in the upcoming elections. We ask for your wisdom in dealing with injustices in our world. We ask for wisdom for our leaders in our world, our countries, our states, and our communities. We ask for wisdom for our church leaders, worldwide and local. We ask for wisdom for pastors as they preach your word, inspire, lead, and grow disciples for Christ. We ask for your wisdom as we reach out to those in need in our communities and in our world. We ask for wisdom as we minister to those who are homebound and in nursing homes. We ask for your wisdom as we minister to those in hospitals in recovery and rehab. We ask for your wisdom that not only enlightens us, but transforms us and guides us on our daily walk with you. And all God's people said, amen. We received two care cards today with one celebration and another that brings grief to our hearts. So today, where is she? There they are. They're sitting apart today. That is not a good sign, Dave. Dave and Loretta are celebrating their 51st wedding anniversary today. That's wow. Wow.
Anniversary.
Yes. And then our hearts will go out to Nick and Lisa Carter, for it's a year ago today that Nancy's family lost Trent. And so we just want to continue lifting them up. And look at, she's got people surrounding her today that she knows loves her. And she knows also that many have been on that same journey in different ways. We all go through different journeys in our lives, but we'll remember Nick and Lisa and the rest of the family today. He has a brother as well that I'm sure is still thinking about all of that today. Let's listen to Sandy for a couple of beautiful moments as we give God thanks for your generosity.
Join us in the doxology, verse 4. Closing hymn of the month is "He Who Began a Good Work in You." It's in the black book, The Faith We Sing, on page 2163, or on the screen.
Thank you.
go now to live into our prayers. As people of faith, I pray that we go now to live in faith, and as people of love, I hope that we go now to live with each other and God in love. That's shalom. That's peace in mind.
Thank you.
I know.